The rest is just a one-click wonder once you set everything right. In this video, we're going to keep expanding the nook sequence we've already covered in the previous video. If you're happy with that basic nook sequence, that's fine as long as it helps you do your work. There's nothing wrong with that.
But for those who would like to have even more flexibility and options and would like to systematically work on details and learn how to develop your own style, this is for you. Okay, the project setting is exactly the same here, so please refer to the previous video for elaboration. Now go back to the color page. This is the basic note sequence we talked about. Just a quick side note that there are many different LUTs and film emulation plugins both in DaVinci Resolve and out on the market. I just happen to use Dehancer Pro, that's all. You can use whichever you're comfortable with, or none at all. Now we're going to expand this sequence. First, I would highly recommend on adding a note to the very end for monitoring. I label it false colors. There is a free plugin called Dehancer Monitor where you can download for free. After installation, find it in your effect library and drag it to the note and turn it on. What it does is that it shows you exactly how your footage is exposed. This is an important tool because your eyes deceive you.
Depending on the calibration of your monitor, or the model of your monitor, or the environment where you edit your videos, your footage could somehow appear darker or brighter than you think it is.
So you might mistakenly crank up or bring down the brightness. And that's where false colors come in handy, because numbers don't lie. They show you exactly where your exposure is, so you know exactly how much and which specific areas need exposure adjustment. And that's how you can also make several clips of the same scene looking consistent. This saves you lots of time and brain power on eyeballing or making blind guesses. Also, stylistically, you can make a clip look more contrasty or smoother, or even filmic. So I have the note at the very end of my note sequence, and I can toggle it on and off. Just make sure you toggle it off before you render the video. Let's go back to the beginning. After the CSD note, I would add a note for noise reduction. Now, I have seen some people add this note before CST, but I'd like to have all the information funneled through CST first. I could be wrong. If so, let me know in the comment section below. You can see that I have a parenthesis in my noise reduction label. That's because I mostly shoot log with my Sony A7C II camera, and I have to say this camera is really, really good. Noise only becomes noticeable when you shoot in very, very low light. Since I switched to Sony A7C II, I haven't really had the need to drastically denoise. But anyway, if you need to denoise, I would suggest you do it here. Like I said in the previous video, I tend to decide whether I have vignette on or off before any adjustment. That's because adding vignette affects the overall exposure. Now, you can add vignette in Dehancer as I showed you in the previous video. But of course, you can use plugins available out on the market. Create a note for vignette here if you're using DaVinci's very own vignette. DaVinci Resolve's vignette has even more parameters than Dehancer's, so if you somehow want to have even more control of your vignette, I'd rather you do it here early in the sequence. But as you can see, I put a parenthesis here. It's optional because not every clip needs vignette. Now let's go deeper. A lot of times we would like to increase or decrease the overall contrast of the shot. In my previous video, I showed you how you can simply do it in your film emulation plugin, which in my case, Dehancer, and adjust the gamma correction.
But to me, this is not so precise. It relies a lot on eyeballing, which to me as a wishy-washy person, it's quite time consuming. There are two other ways to apply contrast more accurately.
After vignette, I add two notes here. The first is contrast with a ratio of 0.336, and I'll explain it in a moment. And then I'll add a serial note called curve, middle gray. Now, when you play with the contrast without setting where the pivot is, you could run the risk of bringing down or up the area where you originally correctly exposed to. And this is why I don't do this in Dehancer, because I want to have a precise pivot point for contrast. Let me introduce middle gray. I don't want to go into details of what it is here. I've included a useful YouTube link in the description below where you can have more information on this. But basically, different profiles have different middle gray points, meaning pivot. When you find the right pivot, increasing or decreasing the contrast will only affect the overall look of the shot. So it just happens to me that the pivot is 0.336 for the DaVinci intermediate color space. The other option for contrast is curve. This gives me even more control of the overall contrast here. Sometimes I just want to soften the low end without affecting the overall exposure. Or maybe I just want to slightly roll off the high end. This comes in handy as long as you find where your middle gray point is. So check out the link in the description and find out how. It's free and it's easy to use. Once you set it up, you're set for life. Occasionally, I would even combine both contrast and curve for artistic purposes. Once I set my contrast, or none at all, I would move to minor tonal adjustments if I need to. Add a serial note and label it HDR. For Rec. 709 pipeline, label it as primaries. Now go to the HDR page. First set your color space and gamma as DaVinci Wide Gamut and DaVinci Intermediate. And then you can adjust the exposure of a specific tonal area. I mostly would pull up the lower end like shadow just to give the whole shot a smoother overall look. You can turn on false colors for more precise adjustments. For Rec. 709 clips, you have to go to primaries. Use color wheels for more overall adjustments or lock wheels for more localized adjustments. For further creative purposes, you can shift the colors of certain tonal areas here and grade your clip. Although I do it in Dehancer, in HDR you can have even more intuitive control. So it's up to you, more options. When I say color adjustments, I'm not referring to the tone or overall grade of the shots here. I'm merely referring to altering specific hue or color density here. Just to give you even more control and flexibility for minor adjustments. So create a serial note. And let's create a several parallel notes here because there are many ways to make small color adjustments. Let's label the first one colors. You can simply go to curve and individually make color adjustments. Simple enough. Or try the second option. Label it as color slice. In color slice, you can individually change the saturation, density, and the value of a specific hue. Whereas in Dehancer, you can only control the overall saturation and density. So this is quite useful because sometimes I only want to make certain colors look richer without affecting the rest. The third option is color whopper. This is an intuitive tool to manipulate colors. Just choose your preferred parameters and start moving to your liking. I personally don't use it so much for my work, but it's an option. Let's say everything is all set. Exposure, look, grade, and the effects are all set and done. I would highly recommend saturation compression if there's a need to. This is because in some situations where there's an abundance of rich and vibrant colors present, the most saturated part could be clipped in a Rec. 709 color space and ugly artifacts could be introduced.
Look, I'm sure most people don't really care. And as always, your video contents are always the most important thing. But if you do care, or if you're making a short film or a music video where details matter, then this is for you.
Like I said in the previous video, you can simply turn on saturation compression in the last CST note. But not all shots need saturation compression, so always, always refer to your Vectorscope. Speaking of Vectorscope, this is a very overlooked monitor to help you precisely shape your grade and look. Not only does it show the saturation level of your clip, but also the punchiness or smoothness of your colors, your grade, and your color balance. These days when I grade, I simply just look at the Vectorscope and other forms because, as I said before, our eyes deceive us. Film grains are more than just adding grains and making your footage more film-like. Actually, I would venture to say that film grains help you manipulate the texture of your clip. That's why we have to, again, pull up your waveform. If I define this as looking clean and dry, then adding the appropriate amount of grains can make it look more creamy. Or for stylistic and storytelling purposes, you can make it look rough and grainy. So this is how you can add grains more systematically, logically, consistently, and stylistically, instead of just simply switching it on. I personally like my footage to look on the creamier side, so I add grains to taste, so to speak. And a quick side note, I tend to sharpen before adding film grains because from my experience, if I add it after, I will sharpen the grains as well. That's it, time to render. These are the settings I talked about at length in my previous video. The only thing I want to re-emphasize is that the most important part of rendering is to have the correct tags. So tag color space tag as Rec 709 and gamma tag as Rec 709A if you're a Mac user like me. Always check the color profile info of your rendered video. It must be 111 for YouTube, otherwise YouTube will change it for you and your videos could appear washed out or color shifted.
First, take a look at the advanced version of my note sequence. Feel free to take a screenshot. Once you set it up, the rest is just a one-click wonder. So copy and paste to all your clips and make the appropriate adjustments. Also, I cannot emphasize enough that learning how to read graphs, forms, and scopes can help your videos looking good and consistent across devices and platforms because numbers don't lie. Less is more. Don't rely on post-production. Spend more time on getting the shot right than spending hours to fix a badly shot clip. One of the biggest reasons why I spend much less time on color grading these days is that the incoming shots are already looking good after the initial color space transform in DaVinci Resolve. So there, feel free to point out what I can do better or what you don't agree on in the comment section below. I'll see you then.